So here we are installing basic system software. Each one of these packages, the packages we use to build the system, and they're all the packages that will be part of the LFS system. So some here will be for convenience, for example, Vim. Others will be essential. Normally a grub will be an essential one, but we won't be installing that because we'll be using the Pies bootloader. PSMISC arguably essential or could be a nice to have, depends, it's half and half really. But yeah, it's a lot of work to do here, so let's crack on. So it explains what to do here. I don't recommend using optimizations. I've tended to find in recent years that optimizations on Linux from scratch, when I have used them, don't seem to have made much difference. Occasionally you do get the odd test failing for unknown reason, and I can normally only put it down to optimization. So there are times when I don't compile with Linux from scratch with optimizations. I would say if you're compiling this on an ordinary Intel machine, don't use optimizations if it's your first time. But otherwise, if you're getting a little bit confident with it, yeah, have a go, see what happens. With this build, so I've found that I've needed to use the optimizations to ensure that the compiler is actually compiling correctly, especially with the floating point unit. It seemed that, or the ABI, it seemed when I was testing that although the Raspberry Pi operating system is using the hard floating point, at one point it did try to use the soft floating point, and that would, I can't remember if it actually errored at that point, but it certainly caused problems later on in the build. And also the tuning, as you remember at the beginning of the videos, that without the tuning it was just going to compile unoptimized. And I can't remember where I read it now, if it's in the GCC manual or elsewhere, that tuning GCC to use the Cortex A72 improves the performance quite noticeably. So yes, I'm using optimizations, and yes, there are some tests that will fail. I don't think they're because of the optimizations. I think it's more about the fact, well, in fact, I know it's not to do with the optimizations. It is about the fact that we're on ARM architecture, and the reason I know that for a fact is because when we come to do GCC, I'll show, after we've done the tests on GCC, that even the GCC developers have errors because they publish the results, but we'll see that. So I know for a fact that errors are expected, and they're not to do with optimizations, they are to do with the architecture. As well as there being failures which the LFS team are aware of and have actually noted that down. But we'll see that when we come to it in GCC. Unfortunately also, there are other packages that fail as well, the odd one here and there. But I can't account for them, and I've not noticed any faults at all. Apart from the tests, the actual system itself, I've not noticed any faults. But there's always that unknown there, unfortunately. So let's carry on. Mentions about libraries and static libraries and so on, dynamic libraries. And there's even a link there about it in the BLFS book. Package management, if you're interested in that, that's worth reading. There's loads of ways of doing it. I've never bothered with it. When I used to have Linux from scratch as my main system, I'd update packages within LFS as I saw fit, which was very rarely. It tended to be the bigger packages that are in BLFS, beyond Linux from scratch, such as at the time it was KDE, Java, LibreOffice, and they were made easier to upgrade by the fact that they were in the opt subdirectory with versioned directories. So it's a simple case of relinking a symlink to those version directories. As far as LFS is concerned, if there were any packages to update, then what I tended to do was just to recompile them and reinstall and hope that the overwriting of the existing version wouldn't cause any problems, and I can't remember that it did. Of course, you've always got in the back of your mind whether there's any old files left around that aren't being used by the new version, but I would expect that to be minimal. The only package I do remember having problems with, and I guess when you think about it, it's expected, is glibc. It's obviously running, it's being used by the system, and overwriting the running one with an updated one just brings the system to a halt, and when you reboot, you've got an inconsistent system, and it's just trash, basically. I've not looked into how the distributions do this. I assume they... Yeah, I don't know. I assume they have some sort of system where the installation appears to happen, but it doesn't actually happen until either shut down or reboot it next time when maybe the library is not in use. Or there's some other way, I don't know. I haven't, like I say, not really looked into it. But that's the only one I wouldn't attempt to update if you do want to update individual packages. The thing I did do in the end was I used to update LFS maybe once every couple of years or so, just rebuild it from scratch. It was a lot of work though, because I have to go through and do BLFS as well, which is why when I found Gen 2, I quickly switched to it, because all of that is automated and taken care of. But by then, I felt I'd learned enough about Linux anyway, and the Linux environment and system, that Linux from scratch had fulfilled its purpose for me, and I just kept it by for, as I said in a previous video, just for servers, because you can create such a small footprint that I don't believe you can with any other distribution, even Gen 2, where you can target packages. You may be able to say that there's, yeah, I won't go into it, but you may be able to do it with a bit of work, but Linux from scratch out of the box is such a small system, and also small footprint memory-wise as well. So it's good for that for me. But I did learn a lot from Linux from scratch. But yeah, enough of that. Let's get on with the build. So let's go into sources. Start with the first package. Nice and simple to get us in the swing of things. Man pages. And just simple install, and that's all there is to this package, and it's done. And now we move on to TCL. So the next three packages are all required for the testing. I think you can skip them if you don't want to test. I've never tried it before, but I wouldn't skip the tests. Run them, at least see what you're producing, how good it is, what it's capable of doing. So TCL, we've got a dash here. Let's see why that is. So we've got a documentation file in HTML and a source file. So we want the source file. Change into the subdirectory, and we can start extracting the help file into this directory with that command. Prepare TCL for compilation. Before I do that, I'm just going to check my C flags are set. Oops, again, if I can set it, spell it properly. CXX flags for the C++ compiler, and just check make flags as well. Yep, that's all set. So let's go straight into... Right, we've got three commands here. We've got an environment variable to get set up. We've got a change directory command, and then we've got the config command itself. So that's configured. I'll run make now. So it says this takes 4 build units. Now it could be down to testing. So let's see how long the make takes. Right, so that is built. We've got some sed commands to run in here, which, as it says at the bottom there, they're not actually required for LFS because there's nothing, I believe what it's saying is nothing that links against TCL in LFS. But in future, for example, if you were to build any of BLFS, it would be necessary that these sed commands exist, so we'll run them in now. Just in case, unset that variable that's set at the top, and we can run some tests. And it says note in the test results, there are several places associated with clock.test that indicate a failure, but the summary at the end indicates no failures, and it passes on a complete LFS system. So that's something to expect. Let's run the tests and see what we get out. Okay, so that is tested, and as you can see, the clock.test has indeed failed. But if I just scroll back, you can see it says failed zero. So that's as expected in the book, so that's all right. We can install the package now. Just change permissions on one file, install some headers for the next package expect, and finally a symbolic link. And now we can tidy up. So back to the sources and remove TCL. And by the way, when you come to the last command, just carry on scrolling right down in case there's more information. There may be something optional. It's easy to want to link to the next page when you think you've finished just by clicking this top link. I've found it's much safer to ensure that you've not missed anything to click this bottom link. But of course, if you're spending time learning the system, then read the contents as well. Learn about what the libraries are and the programs that are being installed. So here we are on expect. Slow down a bit here now. Right, expect, run the configure command. So just to reiterate, everything, all the programs are running now should be running off the disk, the external hard disk, because it's all the programs that we've built. There shouldn't be anything being read from the Pi disk at the moment, because we're using all the tools we've built in the temporary section. So let's now run make to build this. And we can run some tests. Okay, 29 passed out of 29, so that's fine, no failures. Install it. And we've got a sim link to put in as well. And that's expect. And we move on to Deja No, GNU. Okay, so we've got a configure command. And make some documentation with the looks of it. In HTML and plain text. And then we install the package. And install both sets of documentation with this command. And we can run some tests. Okay, now I got this when I did my testing, and what it turned out to be was Deja No is looking for headers which are in a directory that doesn't match the the machine type. So if we did GCC dump machine again, you see we've got ARM V7L LFS Linux GNU EAPI HF. For some reason, something, there's obviously a switch that I've not set correctly, or I've missed something, or something's gone a little bit awry, where this C++ config.h is in the wrong directory. So if I locate it, find C++ config.h. Yeah, there's, ignore this one in the tools because that's the one we were building up originally. It's this one here. Now I'm wondering, would that have been, yeah, I'm not sure when this was. Let's see what date of that file is. But you can see that the directory it's in, ARM V7L LFS Linux dash GNU, is incorrect, and that's why Deja GNU is not finding this header file, because it's not in the right location. Let me just see when this was built to get an idea of maybe what package it was. So 8th, that's actually today's date. So I'm wondering if that's the lib standard that I installed earlier on. And I did wonder about this when I did lib standard the past one. I wasn't sure whether to put the additional flags in that I was putting in before for GCC, which was the with arch, with tune, with FPU, and with float. And I'm wondering if there needs to be another switch in there to specify the actual triplet completely, or to tell it to use a particular one. So maybe that's something I can investigate for another time. But what I did to fix this, it's easy just to copy these headers into the right location. It seems to resolve the issue. So if I go to user include CD10, is that not it? Oh, C++. CDC++. Yeah, so this has been created this morning, so 10.2.0. Yeah, all these have been created this morning. So what I need to do is to modify this directory name to include GNU EABI HF. So move ARM V7. We'll change the name of that to ARM V7 GNU EABI HF. Now, unfortunately, I don't know if this has any impact on anything else that comes later. It may be the cause of some of the errors. I don't think it does, but I can't be sure. As I say, I have built this successfully just with a few errors, which some of which I couldn't account for. But let's do that. Go back to sources. Deja GNU. And rerun the make check. And you'll see that it actually goes through correctly this time, because the headers are being located. And you can see that's actually passed. Yeah, native configuration. Oh, that's interesting. It says unknown and not LFS. So maybe there is a bit more tweaking that needs to be done. But I can investigate that, and if I do another video, which I probably will do, I can include that. Okay, so that's Deja Gnu. Now I've got a really simple one, perhaps the smallest package there is. And it's just a simple, well, two simple files that get copied into etc. And that's it. So now we move on to one of the more important packages, if not the important one, glibc. Okay, so just double check there's no old directory there. No, it's not the reason, it's the patch that's stopping the completion from completing. So first thing we do is to run that patch in and create a build directory, and then we can run the configure command. Okay, and now we can build a package. So I'm going to time this just to get an idea of how long it takes and come back when it's complete. Okay, so that has compiled just under 10 minutes. We can now carry on with preparation for testing. Now, this command here has to be careful because if we were to run this, it wouldn't actually do anything because it's checking for a 32-bit or a 64-bit processor. So what we need to do is to run this command in, but we need to modify the library that is being linked against. So we'll just copy this file, this line here, but we modify the actual library, ldlinux-arm, it should begin, there it is there, armhf.so.3, and you can see that's created the link. So that's the only thing to bear in mind with this bit here. And it says it's needed to run tests at this stage of building the root environment, and it will be overwritten in the install phase below. So let's now run the tests and see how we get on. And as you can see, there are some failures expected. Okay, so that has finished testing, and as you can see, there's a few failures there, but the LFS book has got several failures listed, so we can just double check what we've got against the ones that they know about. So we've got a fail against check local PLT. Can't see that one there. Got some unexpected passes as well. Right, okay, so there's test Elch mod, that's that first one. So that's expected. Some mass tests it mentioned down here where the systems, the CPU is not relatively new Intel or AMD, so that kind of makes sense. Mixed TTY name, that's that one there. So really it's just this one here that's unaccounted for, check local PLT, so I don't know what that's about. So there's no mention there. I suppose it's something you could chase down on the internet to find if it's something specific to ARMS or something else that's causing that problem. But other than that, it's quite a successful build. So let's carry on. Create this file. Got a little sed command here. And we can proceed to install the package. Okay, so that has finished installing. Now what we need to do is to just create this, copy this file and create this directory. What we need to do is create a some like language files, if you like, some the modern language files, they're definitions about the locale, various locales. Just copy this make the directory in, and these locales like specify information about the language, time zone and so on, character map and so on, about the locations where the user that's using the system is localized to. And for, as it says, maximum or optimal coverage of the tests that are going to be coming in the coming packages, all of these need to be installed. Normally you'd only need to install one or two of these. So for a UK, I'd be installing that one, for example, for the UTF-8, and I'd also install a modified version of this one with the ISO 88591 for the UK. So what I'll do is I'll run all these in first of all. I'm going to copy all of these because there's quite a few of them, and just wait for all of them to be installed, and then I'll install the other locale that I will need to use. As I say, it's already got one that I would use, which is UTF-8. It's advisable these days to have a UTF-8 locale. I'll just install another one, which uses the ISO 85591. So as you can see, they take a little while to install. Okay, so that's the last one there, just press an enter after it, and then I'm going to copy this US one and just change the last US to GB and this one to GB as well. So obviously if you're in a different country, then you'll need to ensure that your own locale is installed. It may well be that it's already installed here. Alternatively, you can install every single one, and there's a command here to do that. So that'll take a little while. So the next thing we need to do is to run the create configuration file, and now I need to install some time zone data. So there's a file to extract here, and create a environment variable there. Right, and create a new directory, and then we've got the command here which processes several regions and performs several commands on each of those regions. So I've done that. Copy some files. Run this zik command. And it's correct, as it says down here, that America, New York is there regardless of where you are in the world. And we unset that variable. Now we've got to set the time zone. And there's a little script here to ensure you know what time zone you're in and how it's spelt and laid out and so on. So you just answer the question, so which continent basically are you on? Well, obviously I'm in Europe and I'm in Britain or UK, so it's number 8. And it spits out what it thinks I'm in. It confirms I'm in Britain, yes, and it says the time zone Europe/London will be used. This is it okay? And it's got the date and time there as well to confirm it, so yes. And then it just confirms the output again there. So this output here is what gets substituted in this bit here of this command. So if I just copy that, paste that in, go back and rub out the X's, and instead substitute this Europe/London and press enter, and obviously whatever output you got for your own locale, your own country, that's what you paste in place of those X's there. So now we create the dynamic loader configuration file, and it's advisable to also add this in as well, a directory in case you have configurations in a directory. And that looks like that's it. So let's go back to sources and clean up. Now we can move on to zlib. So we start off with a straightforward configure. And we can build the package. Check the results, that's all okay, and install it. And then just a couple of more little configurations to do to finish the installation off. And it's done. So now we move on to bzip. Oops. Type into the correct window. Okay, so that's not completed. And yeah, it's a patch file, so we just put the dot in to complete the tarball file name. Now I can change you into it. And of course, the first thing we do is we've got a patch to install. Sed command and another one, and then we can start building bzip 2. And it looks like this make command actually compiles and tests it. Yeah, it looks like it's done it up there. So that looks like that's all complete. Install it. And then we've got several things just being moved around or tidied up here. So just copy these in. Again, could copy all this in one go, but it's just easier to do one at a time and see directly under the command what the output is. If you did it all in one go, you'd have to analyze each line, going through picking out what the command was and what the output was. It makes it just a little bit harder, so that's okay. Yep, so let's tidy that one up and we move on to XZ. So, prepare for the compilation. And now we can do the build. Let's test it now. It's all passed, so we can install the package. And just move a few files around and create a symlink. And that's XZ completed. And now we can move on to Z standard. So there's no configure for this one. It just gets made immediately. And also, as you see, there's no test suite either, so it just gets installed directly after being compiled. Okay, let's install it. That's done. So remove a static library and do some more moves and a link. That's complete. And now go into file. So let's configure it. And we build the package now with make. And run some tests on what we've just built. Looks okay. So let's install it. And that's all done. So now move on to readline. So a few set commands to run first of all. And now we can run configure. And let's build a package. That's all compiled. Let's now install it with this command. And once more, just shuffle things around a little bit. With these commands. And optionally, install some documentations. I find documentation is always good to have around. Always gives you a chance to answer questions you may have, or just read stuff to learn more. Okay, so read line's done. Let's remove that and move on to M4. Okay, so we've got a sed. Looks like they append a definition to a header there and start the configuration. Right, that's configured. Let's start compiling and build the package. That's all done. Let's test the build, what's been built. Okay, that's pass, no failures, so let's install it. And that's complete, so let's tidy up. And move on to BC. So prepare it for compilation with this configuration line here. Now, as you can see, it's defining C flags, and that will overwrite our own C flags. So what we need to do here is to add in our own C flags like that. Put a space in, And that should mean that it will use our C flags and the additional standard equals C99. And you can see that's confirmed there. It's actually output the C flags. I've just noticed they're setting the optimization to level 3. Now, because our O2 appears after that O3, it means that the package will be compiled with level 2 optimization and not level 3. So what I shall do is I shall bring this back and just add in minus O3 to the end of this C flags, and that means that it'll be added to the end of the C flags and therefore it will be active. So just rerun that again, and yes, you can see O3. So this O3 here overrides any previously, it's always the last one that is active. So now we can build this. Built okay, let's test it. All DC test pass, that's good. All BC test pass, so that's fine. Now let's run make install. And it's done. Tidy up. And we'll move on to flex. So let's run this configure command. Build the package. And let's run make check now to test what we've just compiled. So that's all passed. Let's run make install and create this symlink to Lex for any packages that need it and tidy up. So now we move on to one of the packages for the tool chain. So this is an important one. Let's extract the package. And we'll run this. We should get this expect LS output, which we do, so that's fine. As it says here, the environment's not set up for proper PTY operation. If you don't get this output, then it needs to be resolved before running the test for bin utils and GCC. I believe the way to fix this is to make some modifications to the kernel to add in BSD PTYs. Otherwise, if you don't do that, you're going to have to miss this tests for bin utils and GCC, which is not really what you want. But obviously on the Pi, kernel, default PyKernel, everything's fine. So let's run this setting. It says to remove a test that prevents a test running to completion. Create a temporary build directory and run in the configure command. And now we can build bin utils. Right, so that's finished compiling. And the next thing we need to do is to get the tests run, which, as it says there, is critical. So not advised to be skipped. Let's time this as well and see what the results are at the end. Right, that's the testing finished, and you can see we've got some unexpected failures there, six unexpected failures, which this is the start of the failures that can't be accounted for. Let's see if we can find them. Yeah, there they are there. So whether these are specifically because of ARM technology or what, I don't know. Let's see if we can do a search of one of these on the internet. So this is actually on the 64-bit, this error has occurred. There's the answer, iFunk support, which is what is being tested here, is still currently experimental, so you can assume it's going to be the same for 32-bit. So that's the kind of thing you're against with these errors when you're looking as to why they're failing. For example, I guess we could try this one as well. Let's get another tab up. Oh, it's actually come up with the same. Oh, probably because it's the same number test, it's just the suffix that's different. Let's try that one. No, that was not actually come up with something. Oh, here's something here. No. So maybe that's one that maybe is a bit of a problem. Okay, there's one here. Oh, again, this is mentioned iFunk again. Again, it's 64-bit, so you can assume it's a similar with 32-bit. So, yeah, that's the sort of thing we're looking at. The errors, but they're known errors, so they can be ignored effectively because there's nothing can be done about it. So let's install binutils. Apart from that, it looks good, so that's promising, because so binutils is part of the tool chain. You don't really want failures at this point. Okay, so that looks like that's complete. Let's tidy that up. And move on to GMP. Now, this says here to specify ABI equals 32 if you're building on a 32-bit x86 CPU. We're not, so we can just run this configuration as it is. It also mentions about the fact that it optimizes for the current host processor, but if you're building for another one that's less capable, obviously within the same architecture, to do these copy commands, so we're not doing that, so we'll just go straight for the configure. And you can see there it says checking ABI 32 as it goes up the screen just there. So that's all configured. You can see, just double check. ARM Cortex 72 Neon is the host type it's decided to use. ABI32, that's the important thing. So that looks good. Let's build it. Right, that's done. Let's build some documentation. And I'm going to run some tests now. Done. Let's compile the documentation. And run the tests. Okay, that looks like that has passed. Yeah, 180 passes, 3 were skipped, so that's great. Let's install it. Install the documentation, and that's MPFR done. And so we move on to MPC next. Once again, we've got config command. Compile the package. Build some documentation and run some tests. Okay, total 67, pass 67, so that's all good. Install and install the documentation, and that's MPC done. So now move on to ATTR. And we'll start with the config as usual. Compile the package. We're on the next type file system, so the test will run. Passed, install the package and just tidy up some files here. And that's done. And now we can move on to ACL. once again with configure. Now we compile the package. Now it says the ACL test need to be run on a file system that supports access controls after core utils has been built with the ACL libraries. If desired, return to this package and run make check after core utils has been built later in this chapter. So won't run make check at the moment, I'll just install it. And I have to try and remember to come back here when we've done core utils or sometime after core utils has been run and rebuild it, test it and reinstall it. And the reason why I reinstall it is because once we've tested it, we know what state what we've just compiled is in. Hopefully it's good, there's no failures and we're installing a good known set of programs that have been tested. So just finish up here and I'll tidy up. And what I'll do is I'll leave this tab open, so I'm going to center click this link to bring a new tab up, and then I've got this tab here to remind me that I need to come back to revisit ACL. So now we've got libcap. Got a little sed here to do, and now we can compile the package. And test it. Passed, so let's just install now. Make some changes. That's libcap complete. And we can move on to shadow. So we've got some changes here. There's a bit here about enforcing strong passwords, and that's part of BLFS. So it just mentions options there. But we'll just stick with the standard LFS build. So just some little changes here, these commands. Another little modification here with this sed command. We don't need to do this because we're not building with crackrib support, so let's just make this change here. Touch the user bin password file and then run the configure. So let's compile it with make. And we can install the package, there's no test that can be run. So now we configure shadow, and first thing we do is we convert the passwords to be shadowed. that command, and likewise the groups. This option here is to decide whether, when you add a user, whether to create a mailbox or not. So I normally add this so that it doesn't create the mailbox. You can get an error sometimes when you delete a user, I think, saying that you can't find the mailbox, but if you remember that you've disabled that, then that's obviously not a problem. Set a root password. So this will be the root password for the root user of the new LFS system when we log into it. So that's what to bear in mind. It's not the root password of the Raspberry Pi operating system that you're setting here. So I've set my password, and that's complete now.